Our region's industries have been a source of pride, prosperity, and pollution. When an important site is damaged, who pays to clean it up? And who decides when the process is complete? That question is being answered at Spirit Lake, just upstream of Duluth. Our friends at the Center for Global Environmental Education at Hamline University sent us this story.
In 1907, construction began on the largest industrial facility ever built in Duluth, Minnesota. A massive U.S. steel plant began to rise on a 1,200-acre site on the shores of Spirit Lake. When its blast furnaces finally fired up 8 years later, the plant began dumping highly toxic waste directly into the lake, a steady stream that flowed for 74 years. The lake receiving this daily dose of untreated pollution was an ecological wonder. Within one of the most biologically rich areas in the Great Lakes, the St. Louis River Estuary, the largest freshwater estuary in the United States. Spirit Lake also happened to be the very heart of the homeland of the Fond du Lac Band of Lake Superior Chippewa.
Mi oma wendakig, gakinegego, ga minwabendak. This is the center of all things. All good things come from here. This land here was truly paradise, if you will, for our people.
The story of Spirit Lake raises important questions. How should we use and care for nature's gifts? What should we do when, in the name of progress, an unholy mess has been made of a sacred place that has nurtured an enduring culture? Who's responsible? And who should pay? And who decides when the healing work is done? Spirit Lake offered spawning, nursery, and overwintering habitat for multiple fish species. Aquatic vegetation, including extensive beds of wild rice, made the lake a haven for migrating waterfowl and shorebirds. This abundance of life was extraordinary, even for the estuary, where warm, nutrient-rich waters carrying sediment from upstream mixed with the cold, nutrient-poor waters of Lake Superior.
And this estuary, in this Gitche Ojibwe Gamizi Bi, the Great Sea of the Ojibwe, is very, very important to us as a people, a survival of a people, living in harmony, living in balance with all of creation.
The new steel plant represented something else entirely, an alternate view of human enterprise and the value and purpose of nature's bounty.
Today's steel mill is the mightiest and most important machine ever to be turned by human hands. And the story of the Iron Masters is more fabulous than any legend, more epic than any story out of Homer.
City leaders were bullish about the new steel plant, which became the region's largest employer. A company town, Morgan Park, was built in the shadow of the steel mill. U.S. Steel provided workers with places to shop, a new school, parks, and a community center. Curving streets were lined with model homes made of concrete blocks from the cement factory that was part of the Duluth Works complex.
There was a lot of interest in what northern Minnesota had to offer from a natural resource perspective as our country was growing. So logging came to the area, minerals were discovered, and then the rails, of course, had to come in because the rails were also a way to transport this material out. And one thing led to another, and Duluth became the largest freshwater port in the world. Significant habitat alteration happened in those years, in the late 1800s, early 1900s, where the wetlands were filled and slips were carved to create the system that provided for transport of raw materials. There were tremendous logging mills and operations right down on the waterfront, and that's part of the damage that occurred in that area, is there was a lot of wood waste placed in a lot of these bays and rivulets in the estuary.
By the mid-1800s, about the time this industrial activity was getting started, the Fond du Lac Band had been removed from the estuary to a reservation 30 miles upstream. Vast areas of their homeland were ceded to the U.S. government through treaties that reserved for the band rights to hunt, fish, and gather in places like Spirit Lake.
The reservation is referred to as the leftover. And if you look at it, you know, as far as its value to those that were here initially, I mean the land of the reservation, 40% of it is wetland. And that's valuable to us. We call that Mashkiki, the medicine land, a place where you find your medicines. But we also consider this our homelands as well.
The very heart of those homelands includes Spirit Lake and Spirit Island, which hold a hallowed place in Ojibwe history. That history tells of a migration by the tribe over many generations, a westward journey from the eastern seaboard.
They would be where they were supposed to be when they found the food that grew up out of the water, and that was manomin, or wild rice. Spirit Island is the sixth stopping place on the Ojibwe's migration through the Great Lakes. And it continues to hold huge significance through the history and the cultural traditions that are even today continue to be practiced in that place.
Sometimes I see all of the development over here in the estuary as an abomination.
After decades of unchecked contamination from the steel plant, the 1960s and 70s brought change. Demand for domestic steel declined, and a growing environmental movement and new pollution laws threatened the economic viability of the Duluth Works plant. U.S. Steel began closing down operations, and by 1979, the facility was fully shuttered. A final group of 250 workers lost their jobs.
Duluth Works U.S. Steel was the best company that U.S. Steel has ever had.
How come they closed it up?
They made a mistake when they closed it up.
Those families that remained in Morgan Park lived in the shadow of a rusting ruin that stood for another 10 years. The reckoning began of how to make right the extensive damage that had been inflicted on Spirit Lake and who was responsible. Duluth Works was designated as a Superfund site in 1984. U.S. Steel was on the hook for an initial cleanup that took 13 years, but that was just the beginning.
The job wasn't done. There was still free product. Oily substances, PAHs, heavy contamination that was bubbling up in the water and on the landscape.
Though U.S. Steel had built and managed the Duluth Works plant, the question of who was responsible for the mess it created wasn't quite so simple. Before the plant was built, iron ore from the Mesabi Range had been shipped through the Great Lakes to Eastern steel mills. Members of the Minnesota legislature realized that the state was missing out on a big opportunity.
So in 1907, the Minnesota legislature passed a tax on the export of raw minerals out of Minnesota, thereby forcing U.S. Steel to develop a steel mill on Spirit Lake in Duluth. It was a state-sponsored, subsidized effort to get jobs in Duluth and to keep jobs in Minnesota. So there is public sector complicity in the problems that occurred.
The Environmental Protection Agency began planning the next phase of the cleanup, with EPA and the steel company sharing the costs. As federal funds were now involved, and because the plant was within the band's ceded territories, the EPA was required to get input from the Ojibwe about the cultural significance of the estuary's lands and waters, and the special importance of Spirit Lake and Spirit Island.
And that consultation led to some interesting dialogue between the tribal representatives and the EPA representatives, where we did our best to educate them on what that cultural significance entailed.
The Rock Nation. In English, the rocks are inanimate. In our language, in Ojibwe, they're animate. They're alive, they have motion, they have spirit, they have power. The Rock Nation came first, the mountains, the stone people. Next was the seedlings, the grasses, the bushes, the trees. They came next in order. The seedlings, the grasses, the trees give us the oxygen to live. And then next came the animals, the flyers, the four-leggeds, the swimmers, the crawlers. They came next. They gave us the brotherhood. Last was Anishinaabe. We were lowered here. We were put here. From where? I always told from the star world. So we're last in that order of things. So all those other beings can live without us. We can't live without them.
We were strongly advocating for as much of that contamination to be dredged and removed from the water.
Fond du Lac got partners together and we sat down around the table and put together this concept plan with the idea that we wanted to say, this is what we envision this place being like when the U.S. Steel remediation project was going on.
It took another 20 years for this second cleanup to play out as part of what became a massive effort to address pollution throughout the estuary, which had been designated one of the most degraded areas in the Great Lakes. Overall costs reached about $1 billion, and yet...
There's never enough. You know, there's always something more to do. And we were trying to define, for this program, we need a finite list of things we have to do to get this designation removed. And we can't keep adding to it, because then we'll never be done. And so that was part of the push and pull, was to manage this plan with a known certain set of outcomes, get the funding and get it delivered.
As sorely needed treatments have been applied to the estuary's most serious wounds, the band has continued to advocate for a healing of Spirit Lake that honors its cultural significance.
I would estimate that the recently completed remedial project removed somewhere in the neighborhood of a third to a half of the volume of contaminated sediments. The fact that there is this much toxic poison in the sediments, it affects nebi, or water, which is considered the lifeblood of Mother Earth. And as long as that contamination remained in the water, just that knowledge is enough to impact the cultural and historic and traditional integrity of Spirit Island.
From the ecological standpoint, maybe we've reached the cleanup of contaminants to levels that are considered safe for people to be around. But we certainly haven't addressed all of the impacts to the place.
The EPA ultimately agreed that leaving so much polluted sediment in the water adversely impacted Spirit Island. The agency gave funds to the band for them to work toward a more complete redemption of Spirit Lake. By the summer of 2024, the cleanup involving EPA and U.S. Steel had come to an end. In July, many of the parties to that process gathered to celebrate the opening of a trail that runs along the shore of Spirit Lake past the former site of the steel plant.
Our work is turning degraded waterfront areas into vibrant local attractions.
Now we see a different view of what the natural resources and the outdoors are, their amenity, their quality of life.
For the Fond du Lac Band, the work continues.
There's a heck of a lot that we can do that gets us back to a more historically healthy, ecologically functioning system. The ability to come back down here and harvest rice again, to be able to come back and harvest fish. This used to be a place where there were fish camps for Fond du Lac band members 100, 200 years ago. That's also how we heal our community.
We have to share the earth anyway, but we should share it in a reciprocal way where we respect one another and respect all of the gifts of God's creation that benefits humanity and all of the animals and plants as well. Human beings are the last order of creation. Plants and and so on were created before us. All that they ask of us is to be grateful.
Thanks so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like and subscribe, and check out our YouTube channel for even more Great Lakes Now. See you out on the lakes.